Chapter 6, early childhood. Young people. Whoops, wait a minute. We got it. At about 3, children begin to look more slender and athletic. Abdominal muscles develop. The toddler pot belly tightens. The trunk, the arms, and legs grow longer. Head is still relatively large. Both boys and girls will grow 2 to 3 inches per year and gain 4 to 6 pounds. The early lead a boy has at birth is maintained and will be continued through puberty, when girls will catch and pass boys. And there's my grandson and his buddy JJ, both wearing their Spider-Man shoes. My grandson is the taller one. That N stands for Nebraska. And that says FLA, I think. There he is when he was a baby. You can see his pot belly. There he is a little bit older, 18 months. There he is a little bit older at the beach in Florida. And there he is eating ice cream and showing off his blue tongue. I think it was Blue Moon ice cream with his Captain America shirt on. And now these aren't they? Yes, they're Batman shoes instead of his Spider-Man shoes. Cartilage begins turning to bone faster after the age of 3, giving children a more rigid structure. This is usually needed since a child tends to become more adventurous and requires the added protection of hardened bones. And this is a growth plate, as you can see. This is in the leg. That's the growth plate. That's what the doctors are all looking for. One of the interesting phenomena of children at this age is the flexibility of their hardening bones. When a child hurts a limb, there might actually be damage that is difficult to see on an x-ray. And having worked in x-ray for a number of years, I can tell you this is a tough one. This is a tough one to be able to see these fractures. And it's actually right here. And as you can see it better from this side. But that's it right there. That's a green stick fracture. This is known as a green stick fracture because the bone breaks in a similar manner to a green stick. Doesn't break completely. That stays together. But it's still broken. And they usually call it cracked. But it's right there. And you can see that it's not in the right position right there. So that'll have to be straightened out. Not too much, just a little push, I guess. And it'll knit together in 3 or 4 weeks. There you go. See, as you can see, it didn't break all the way through. Just cracked. Kind of like a green stick. And there's another one. You can see the crack. Yeah, cracked a bone. There you go. Muscular, skeletal, and nervous system growth increases as children begin to look more and more like little adults. While it is important that little adults, wait a minute, there you go, little adults with blue tongues. while it is important that children get good food in adequate amounts, many children of this age become really picky eaters. A diminished appetite at this age is normal. A child may seem to eat small amounts, but it is probably enough to keep themselves properly nourished. A child does require a proper amount of sleep for good growth. Maintaining a 20-minute period of relaxation before bedtime will set the mood for a good night's sleep. Preschoolers eat less in proportion to their size than infants do. Obesity today is more common among preschoolers than we have ever seen before. Fast and snack foods seem to dominate diets. These foods are full of fat and sugar. Children should be fed from the 5 major food groups with an eye kept on the fat content. Meats and dairy products are essential to good bone and muscle growth. 11% of all 4 to 5 year old boys and 5% of all 4 to 5 year old girls are considered obese. Obesity is categorized when body mass index, or BMI, weight in comparison with height, is in the 95th percentile. The proportion of the children ages 6 to 17 who are obese more than doubled between 1981 and 1991, from 5% to 11%. Oddly, the standard for obesity has changed from 85 percentile to 95th percentile, and still the numbers have more than doubled. Obesity often results from an inherited tendency, aggravated by too little exercise and too much or the wrong kinds of food. Environment is influential since children model the eating habits of people around them. Inactivity may be a major factor. Obese children often suffer emotionally because of taunts from peers. They tend to become overweight adults, which leads to high blood pressure, heart disease, orthopedic problems, and diabetes. Over-concern with body image can lead to eating disorders, especially among girls. In one study of 9 to 10-year-old girls, 40% were trying to lose weight. And here are the trends of obesity. As you can see, that's not too bad. 15 to 19% only in four different states. Of course, then in 1995, half the states. Now we've got half the states are so overweight, so much more overweight than they were before. And now we see the same thing, 2006. The whole middle of the country is overweight. Comparison of percentages of population classified as obese. The fattest males are the males in the United States. This is Argentina. That's Mexico, Russia. Finland, Germany, no, this is Finland, I'm sorry. Finland, this is England. That's England, that's Germany, that's Finland, that's Spain, that's Italy, and this is France. So the skinniest, these are females, I'm sorry. The skinniest females are French, and the fattest females are American. For the male population, Argentina is number one, United States, England, Finland, Germany, Mexico, Spain, Russia, Italy, and the French males are the skinniest, are the slenderest, let's say that. Oral health, tooth decay in early childhood often stems from overconsumption of sweetened milk and juices in infancy. Permanent teeth, which begin to develop long before they appear at about age 6, may be affected if thumb sucking does not stop after age 4. And this is what happens with thumb sucking. You get an overbite. Actually, you're also pushing your bottom teeth in. I have a brother with a problem like this. My grandson seems to have a bit of an overbite. Most adult teeth arrive when primary teeth begin to fall out at about age 6. Between 1974 and 1994, the number of children with untreated cavities dropped nearly 80%. Much of the improvement is attributed to adhesive sealants on the chewing surfaces, and that certainly does help. Children in different cultures may get the same amount of sleep each day, but its timing may vary. Young children may develop elaborate routines to put off retiring. Transitional objects or bedtime companions help a child shift from dependence in infancy to independence in late childhood. In one longitudinal study, children who were allowed transitional objects at age 4 tended to be well-adjusted to teenagers by age 16. Gross motor skills involve the large muscles, such as running and jumping, sports, dancing, etc. Fine motor skills involve small muscles in hands and fingers, such as tying shoelaces and cutting with scissors, writing, drawing, etc. And this is a picture of my grandson. And as you can see, he's got his scissors correctly. He's kept trying to cut correctly. And everybody else seems to be having a lot of problems, especially her. There we go. But this is my grandson right here. The best one. Handedness is the preference for using one hand over the other. This is usually evident by 3 years of age. Most people are left hemisphere dominant and so become right-handed. If the left and right hemispheres are symmetrical, the individual will become left-handed. It's about 10% of any population are left-handed. This is actually, the figure has gone down. It's somewhere between 8 and 9% now. When I was teaching in on the Fort Belknap Reservation, I can remember one class I had about 30 students, and there were like 17 of them that were left-handed. It was just the most bizarre thing I've ever seen. Because you don't think about whether somebody's left-handed or right-handed unless you see them write, because otherwise it really doesn't come up. And here they were taking notes with their left hand. It was just bizarre. Artistic development. Children's early pictures show energy and freedom. Later they will show care and accuracy. Coughs, sniffles, stomach aches, and runny noses are part of early childhood. Since the lungs are not fully developed, respiratory problems are fairly common, though not as frequent as they were during infancy. 3 to 5 years old's average 7 to 8 colds or other respiratory illnesses in any given year. These minor illnesses tend to build immunity and actually assist in fighting off more severe diseases. As the child ages, they will contract fewer and fewer respiratory illnesses as their lungs get bigger. And this is my grandson. Once again, there's a reason why he's smiling. The cat normally wouldn't let him touch her, but she was asleep. And it was like 2 o'clock in the morning. He had a fever, and that's one of the reasons why his cheeks are so rosy. He had a fever, and he was awake at 2 o'clock, and the cat was asleep, and so he got to touch her. So there you go. Lucky him. Motor vehicle injuries. 20% of child deaths due to motor vehicle accidents are alcohol-related. 2/3 of these deaths are due to a drunk driver in the child's own vehicle. All the states in the United States require children to ride in special safety seats or to wear seat belts. Children and adults who are small are in danger from airbags. In many states, children are required to ride only in the back seat. In most states, child-proof caps are required on all medications to prevent accidental poisoning. Children born to women under the age of 20 are 15 times more likely to die from accidental injury. And I can remember when my grandson was living in Florida, their law was that you had to be a certain height before you could ride in the front seat. And so the whole time he was down there, he was riding in the back seat. And then he came to Iowa, and the requirement was different here. So actually, he could have ridden in the front seat, but his mother didn't want him to. We won't go into that. Preschoolers in daycare centers are 2 to 4 times more likely to pick up mild illnesses than children raised at home. Colds, flu, diarrhea, middle ear infections, another name is otitis media, gastrointestinal illnesses, and hepatitis A. And when I was in the service, we had 2 hepatitis outbreaks in the nursery. Not the nursery, in preschool on base. It was interesting, really kind of curious. Everybody had to get gamma globulin shots. So how does it work? You get 1 cc for every 100 pounds you are. So if you weigh 200 pounds, you get 2 cc's of gamma globulin. I think I weighed 140 pounds at the time, so I got 1.4 cc's. You get it, and you got to get it in your butt. There's no other place to put it. This is gamma globulin. You don't want it in your arm. Still have the knot. In the United States, 43% of children between 2 months and 11 years are exposed to secondhand smoke every day. This increases the probability that the child will develop bronchitis, serious infectious diseases, illnesses, otitis media, burns, and asthma. There are more children living in poverty in the United States than there were in 1973. Low income is the chief factor associated with poor health in children and adolescents. Many times the health problems begin before birth, as the future mother is malnourished and receives inadequate nutrition during pregnancy. Medicaid has served as a safety net for the very poor. 890,000 children in the United States have high levels of lead in their blood. This happens because they are exposed to lead fumes or eat lead-contaminated food or water. Lead-based paints in older houses are also a source of contamination. Lead poisoning is associated with sensory motor problems, lower IQ, poor academic achievement, hyperactivity, short attention span. And of course, when we were living in Germany, we were in Germany from 79 to 82. They were using leaded gas. And it was a problem because they built the schools close to the Autobahn, so close to big roads. And the reason was because the land was cheaper, and so that's where they built their school. And they were having a lot of problems with lead poisoning. The American schools were on base, and they had a different lead problem because they were putting lead in JP4, the jet fuel, and they were practicing dumping jet fuel all over the place. Maltreatment is the deliberate or avoidable endangerment of a child. Abuse is an action that inflicts harm, for example, physical, sexual, or verbal harm. Neglect is inaction that leads to harm, for example, not meeting a child's basic needs, such as food, clothing, and medical care. And this little child has been, dipped in scalding water, and that's why he's got... that's why he is burnt all the way up to the top of his torso. In 2012, 3.3 million cases of child abuse were reported in the United States involving 6 million children. 78% involved neglect, 18% involved physical abuse, 9% involved sexual abuse. More than half the reported victims are 7-year-olds or younger, 1/4 are below the age of 4. Girls are 3 times as likely as boys to be sexually abused. Boys are the most likely to be physically abused or neglected. 8 out of 10 cases of sexual abuse are perpetrated by the child's parents. 2/3 of the abuse cases are by the child's biological parents. So it isn't the boyfriend. It can be the boyfriend, but it's more than likely it's the biological parents that are doing it. So why in the world would boys be more likely to be physically abused or neglected? And this has to do with women who aren't married. Sometimes they will abuse their sons because they look like their dads. That's not uncommon. Not the only reason, of course. There's lots and lots and lots of reasons why they would abuse. In 2018, 4.3 million cases of child abuse were reported in the United States involving 7.8 million children. 60.8% involved neglect, 10.7% involved physical abuse, 7% involved sexual abuse. Just over half the reported victims were 5 years old or younger. 26.7% were less than 1 year of age, while 25% were between 2 and 5 years of age. 5 children die every day as a result of child abuse. 80% of the children who die from abuse are under the age of 4 years. 50 to 60% of fatalities due to maltreatment are not recorded as such on the death certificate. 1/3 to 2/3 of child maltreatment cases involve substance use to some degree. Children whose parents abuse alcohol and other drugs are 3 times more likely to be abused and 4 times more likely to be neglected as children of non-abusing parents. 2/3 of the people in treatment for drug abuse admit to being abused or neglected as children. Maltreatment by parents represents extremely poor child rearing practices. Family problems are often exacerbated by poverty, alcoholism, antisocial behavior. A disproportionate number of abuse cases come from large, poor, or single-parent families who cannot meet the needs of their children. However, most low-income parents do not abuse their children. Many abusers are lonely, unhappy, anxious, depressed, angry, or aggressive. They tend to have low self-esteem, poor impulse control, and poor coping skills. About one-third of abusive parents were abused themselves as children. In one-third of the cases, substance abuse is a factor. Abusive parents tend to be overly involved with their children. Deprived of good parenting themselves, they tend to be upset by behavior that most parents accept as normal. Abuse may occur when an already stressed parent attempts to control a child physically and ends up shaking, striking, or squeezing the child. Abusive parents tend to have marital problems and fight physically. Their household tends to be disorganized. They tend to experience stressful events. Many isolate themselves from society and have no one to turn to in times of stress. Neglectful parents tend to be apathetic, incompetent, irresponsible, emotionally withdrawn. Abused children tend to be overly needy or demanding. They tend to cry often or may be unresponsive. The child's greater needs may stem from poor health, difficult personalities, or physical disabilities. They are more likely to be preterm or low birth weight, hyperactive, have a mental deficit, physically handicapped, or have behavioral abnormalities. Neighborhood factors that lead to abusive environments include poverty, unemployment, job dissatisfaction, social isolation, lack of social service assistance, high crime rates. In societies where societal violence is rare and physical punishment of children is frowned upon, child abuse is rare. That's true in Japan, China, and Tahiti. In contrast, the United States has one of the most violent cultures among the industrialized nations. Maltreatment can produce grave long-term consequences, physical, cognitive, or social. They're more likely to repeat a grade. They're more likely to do poorly on cognitive tests. They are more likely to have behavioral problems in school. As infants, abused children tend to have disorganized, disoriented attachment to their parents. They have a hard time developing social skills and tend to have a hard time making friends. They may become either overly aggressive or withdrawn. They tend to be fearful, uncooperative, and less able to respond appropriately to friendly overtures. Preschoolers have anxiety, nightmares, inappropriate sexual behavior. Oh, this is a reaction to sexual abuse, sorry. As preschoolers, this is what you will potentially see. They're very anxious. They report having nightmares. They may engage in inappropriate sexual behavior. School-aged children show a lot of fear. It may manifest itself as a mental illness. They may be overly aggressive. They may have nightmares as well. They may have school problems. They will show hyperactivity. And regressive behavior. In other words, they act younger than they actually are. Adolescents suffer from depression, withdrawn. They will be withdrawn. They may be suicidal. They may perform a lot of self-injurious behavior. And this is what it looks like. In this case, that's skin popping, actually. Or she's burned herself with a cigarette. Here she is, she's a cutter, so she's been slicing her arm. Physical complaints, illegal acts, running away, substance abuse. While most do not abuse, children are more likely to become delinquent, criminal, or mentally ill. A longitudinal study following 68 victims of childhood sexual abuse found that they suffered from lower self-esteem, depression, anxiety, and unhappiness. In emotional maltreatment, the effects are harder to pinpoint, but the problem is linked to lying, stealing, low self-esteem, emotional maladjustment, dependency, underachievement, depression, aggression, learning disorders, homicide, murder, or suicide. Self-injury. Helping families in trouble or at risk, intervention strategies should be comprehensive, neighborhood-based, centered on protecting children and aimed at strengthening families. State and local child protective services agencies investigate reports of child maltreatment and determine what steps, if any, need to be taken. Toughest job in the world, child protective services. I had a student when I was at Fort Belknap who started working at Child Protective Services on Fort Belknap. And, of course, she became the enemy of just about everybody because anytime she even suggested that a child be taken out of the home, the whole family, you know, the whole network of the family would complain. Finally, she got the head CPS job on the Crow Reservation. It's a little bit easier for her. They couldn't threaten her family because they were up on Fort Belknap. So it was just easier for her to seize a child when it's not, you know, your neighbor or somebody that you went to high school with, you know, that kind of stuff. So it's a little bit easier on the Crow Reservation for her. Many children learn aggressive behavior from their families. Aggression is defined as any hostile action that causes fear and leads to forceful contact with another. It can be directed at people or things. It can be physical, verbal, or both. It can be positive or negative. In early childhood, physical aggression tends to decrease as verbal aggression increases. Researchers see the ability to make their wishes known and delay gratification as reasons to reduce physical aggression. And this baby's pulled that other... has pulled the car over. Ah! What does it say? I've never even looked at that before. Dylan, I think. Yeah, it says Dylan something. Oh, okay. They messed up the last name so you couldn't see who it was. Research ideas are where aggression originates. Does it originate in genetics? Is it a psychobiology? Is it a cognitive process? Does it have to do with the family environment? All children act aggressively at times, despite the rationale supporting it. Researchers feel that aggressive behavior can be curtailed by reinforcing prosocial behavior. There are other differences between males and females than reproductive anatomy. Boys are more vulnerable from conception through the first year, but tend to be longer and heavier than their female counterparts. They seem to be more active from birth. They react to stress differently. Gender typing is common in most cultures and tend to be promoted by the males. This is shown in rougher play with boys and more sensitivity in girls. Let me tell you a quick story. My mom got pregnant right after she married my dad. He was going off to war. He's going off to Europe. And so here's my mother's pregnant, and he's in Europe, and the baby stops moving. And she didn't ever move very much to begin with, but she just stopped moving almost completely. And so my mother thought, well, she is getting bigger. She keeps getting bigger, but she's just not moving around. So my mother finally gives birth to this little girl. They knocked her out to so that she could have the baby. She was only it's a little tiny thing. My mom was only about 4'8". Anyway, so she has the baby, and she's surprised that the baby's still alive. And it turns out that my sister, Norma was her name, just was not a mover. She just never moved. She just kind of sat and looked, and she was really smart. That wasn't her problem, but she just was not a mover. And eventually, of course, you don't get very much exercise. It comes back and bites you in the butt. She She developed problems from not moving. There are things that happen to you if you don't move. You gotta move. You gotta move around and get your blood flowing and get that all that digestive stuff out of your system. That's how you get to go to the bathroom. Verbal ability. Girls tend to begin speaking earlier and maintain the superiority in verbal ability over boys all their lives. Mathematics. After puberty, boys' math scores tend to be higher than girls, and they tend to do better and participate in more complex math courses, which doesn't mean that girls aren't good at math. That just means they stop doing it. It may be cultural. Who knows? Spatial ability. Boys seem to have greater ability to manipulate figures in their minds than girls. Social influences. Girls are more likely to follow adult supervision than boys. And all of this may be cultural. And it may be that our culture is changing in the United States. Who knows? Aggression. Boys are more likely to use physical aggression in their play and to get their way, while girls participate in more cooperative play and use relational aggression to get their way. They threaten relationship structures as punishment for not getting what they want. Emotional sensitivity. Girls are better able to express their emotions and interpret the emotions of others than boys. And of course, this may be cultural as well. By age 2 or 3, children understand that they are either girls or boys, and they label themselves as such, and this is known as gender labeling. As children go through the preschool years, children understand that they will grow up to be men or women, depending on their gender, and this is known as gender stability. By kindergarten or the beginning of elementary school, children understand that gender will not change according to their wishes or by situation, so that they can be a fireman or a nurse. This is known as gender constancy. Males are bathed in copious amounts of androgens during gestation, which leads to their masculine behavior during childhood. It is the increased androgens during gestation that seems to make the boy baby act in a masculine fashion. With puberty, male increases in testosterone can surge to 10 times the previous level in a week. And that's why boys are so crazy during when they're going through puberty. I can remember when I went through puberty, I didn't sleep for like 2 weeks. I just didn't sleep. And I'd lay down in bed and my brain would just spin like crazy. Well, I did sleep, I'm sure I did. It wasn't easy. It was a tough time. If allowed to gravitate toward the people that they are the most comfortable with, boys will play with boys and girls will play with girls. Children will resist playing with opposite sex partners, whether they are forced to or not. Children seem to be unhappy when they are forced to play with opposite sex playmates. Now, this all may be cultural as well. When girls and boys play, it often turns conflictual because girls' interactions are cooperative or enabling to sustain play, and boys' play is constricting, where one playmate tends to emerge as the victor. When girls play with boys, the girls have a difficult time because the boys do not respond to suggestions. Boys do not want to resolve the conflict with discussion. They want to fight. Some researchers feel, and this may be cultural as well, some researchers feel that these differing styles may have an evolutionary basis. Males have evolved needing to establish position and rank in a group to survive. The female role in a group is to seek cooperation and provide an environment for the nurturing of offspring. Males had to compete with other males for reproductive rights. Women had to seek cooperation from other women and males to maintain their offspring. Parents influence children while they are playing in several ways. Sometimes they act as playmate. When they play with children, they may scaffold other behavior or changes in play to make the play more sophisticated. They may act as a mediator when they are playing with another child. They act as a social coach. The interaction is more positive if the child is securely attached to the parent. Play involves the implicit and explicit rules that the players follow the same rules for the benefit of the fun that is occurring. Cooperation is more and more likely to occur as the children get older. The younger the children are, the more egocentric they tend to be, and the less likely that they are to have the language skills to negotiate cooperation. Children will model their peers' behavior, so if other peers are cooperating, they will be more likely to cooperate too. Willingness to cooperate within the groups leads to more cooperative behavior. Less leads to egocentrism. Long-lasting cooperation is delicate because the first inkling of its decline will lead to a flurry of egocentric behavior. So when we talk about egocentric, what we're talking about is spoiled, okay? That's what we're talking about. Different cultures support cooperative behavior more fervently. In China, they put a high premium on interdependence and group cohesion. Cooperation is lauded and modeled. In studies in China and Canada, observers found that cooperative play occurred 85% of the time with a select age group in China and 22% with the same age group in Canada. Cooperative play leads to the modeling of other behavior. Prosocial behavior, or behavior that benefits another person, is more likely when cooperative play has been previously displayed. Prosocial behavior can lead to behavior where someone else benefits and the child isn't looking for any extrinsic benefits for themselves. And this is known as altruism. Some scientists believe that humans are predisposed toward this type of behavior because of our inability to survive without others. Prosocial behavior and altruism are preceded by understanding of the probable feelings of others. This is known as empathy. Other feelings that lead to prosocial feelings and behaviors include feelings of responsibility, feelings of competence in the activity, mood of the child during the activity, understanding the social costs of the altruism. Ways to get children to foster prosocial behavior: model the behavior desired, be warm and supportive in disciplinary practices, accentuate opportunities to behave in a prosocial manner. The most communicative message the parents can give their children is to act altruistically themselves. Some children prefer to play alone. This is usually not a problem, as every child will have episodes where they prefer to play by themselves. One sign that the child is having trouble is if they wander from one game to another, but never attempt to join or participate with others in play. Obviously, they want to interact, but can't. This child needs to be helped by adults to interact with their peers, or they might accept the role of the rejected peer. As children interact more and get used to being around each other, they will begin to play with one another. Unoccupied play is where a child watches others but does not engage in the activity themselves. Onlooker play is where the child is near enough to others while they are playing to make comments but not engage in the activity themselves. Associative play is where they join into the activity. Children are at the preschool age and will begin recognizing peers and developing formative relations or friendships. Friendships at this point are usually momentary and lived short-lived, though they are most likely to play with whomever is in the vicinity or momentary playmateship. And this is my grandson right here and right here. I hope he didn't have to hit anybody. Rough and tumble play is vigorous play, such as wrestling, kicking, tumbling, grappling, and sometimes chasing, often accompanied by laughing and screaming. This play peaks in middle childhood. It drops to about 5% of playtime by the age of 11. This is a universal type of play, since it takes place during childhood through adolescence in many diverse cultures, countries. And this is one of the problems that we had with my sister, the one I told you about that never moved. She hated her brothers because we made so much noise. We made way too much noise because we were always doing this. We even got a set of boxing gloves, two sets. We got boxing gloves one Christmas. I have no idea what my mother had in mind when she bought the boxing gloves, but what she got was a bunch of split lips. My brother bit his tongue. Pretty soon the boxing gloves disappeared. There were four boys in my family. And of course, you know, it's competition. So hey, this looks like fun. Wasn't fun. Rough and tumble play. And he's strangling him, but you can see this kid's laughing. I don't know if this kid's laughing. He's the one being strangled. This kid, I don't know. Organized sports are represented by organized athletic programs. Nearly 20 million U.S. children under 14 take part in team sports outside of school. 75% of these children will quit by age 15. Too often, the focus is on excellence and winning rather than playing and exercise. Metacognition refers to the person's ability to think about thinking. Metamemory is a person's strategies of remembering, or at least the process of understanding their ability to remember. Cognitive self-regulation refers to the strategies used to enhance memory. It isn't until the age of 6 years that the child understands that two people seeing the same thing may interpret it differently, and this is known as egocentrism. A child will be in the preoperational stage of cognitive development from age 2 until about age 6. Piaget's three mountain task, a preoperational child is unable to describe the mountains from the clown's point of view, an indication of egocentrism according to Piaget. Another example of egocentrism is animism, or giving inanimate objects the power to think and move. Calvin's toy tiger, Hobbes, is a good example of a boy's imagination and its power to bring inanimate things to life. Piaget referred to the narrow focus of children in the preoperational stage as centration. A good example of centration is conversion, or the inability to understand that when something changes its shape, it doesn't change its properties. And of course, she's looking at these two containers and she's trying to decide if this is more than this. And the reality is no, it's exactly the same. Children in the preoperational stage of cognitive development tend to only think in one direction, a thought process called irreversibility. Math may be confusing for some because they understand addition, but subtraction, reversing the process, baffles them. Okay, here's an ice cream. That's a, what do they call them? Dreamsicle, that's what they call them. It's a dreamsicle. It's ice cream covered in orange sherbet and frozen solid. By the preoperational stage, children have become adept at classifications, understanding that many things can be arranged through the process, by this process, such as shapes, colors, textures, materials, yada, yada, yada. Children in the preoperational stage tend to see events that happen together as causing each other. If their father grunts with disgust every time he sees a bad news story on TV, the child might assume that whenever their father sees the news anchor on TV, their father will grunt with disgust. They see cause and effect where it probably does not exist. Children at this age will sometimes have a difficult time telling the difference between physical events and psychological events misinterpreting something that should have happened with something that does happen, and this is called precausal thinking. The real from the imagined, the fantasy from reality, nightmares from reality. Lev Vygotsky developed his cognitive development theory based on what he observed in his native Russia. He saw children developing because they tried harder and harder tasks and were helped to learn their new tasks by their teachers and parents. Vygotsky felt that learning could only take place if the level of a child's knowledge was close enough to the desired knowledge to allow a knowledgeable other to assist in the learning. This is known as the zone of proximal development. When Anne tries to put a puzzle together on her own, she can't do it. When Anne puts a puzzle together with her father, he sometimes shows her how pieces can go together. They always finish. This is an example of zone of proximal development. Teachers and parents aid children in learning by giving assistance, but only as much as the child needs to accomplish the tasks themselves. This is known as scaffolding, not doing it for the child, but assisting the child. Scaffolding becomes so ingrained in a child's life that when they are trying to do something on their own that is difficult, they will talk to themselves while they are doing it. This is known as private speech. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. Some children are perpetually restless, fidgety, and impulsive. They have a hard time controlling their actions and behaviors. 3 to 5% of school-aged children are diagnosed with ADHD, and the symptoms are overactivity, unable to keep still, unusually energetic. Inattention. They do not pay attention and seem to be unable to concentrate on schoolwork. Impulsivity. They seem to act before thinking. About half of the children suffering from ADHD will carry it into adulthood. More children are diagnosed with ADHD than in the past. Many researchers feel that this is not due to the misdiagnosis, but because of improved diagnostic techniques. Doctors are picking up children that were missed before, especially girls who were often excluded because of their gender. ADHD is treatable. While drug therapy has been shown to work on most ADHD cases, counselors have shown that concentrated family intervention techniques such as multimodal treatment study for children with ADHD, MTA, has proven effective. And so you provide positive attention, you give effective instructions, you praise your child's effort, you establish rewards, you use consistent consequences. Communicative disorders may afflict anyone as they are growing up and make learning and using language difficult. Voice disorders are difficulty with the quality of voice and may make speech unintelligible. Three of them are breathiness and nasal tone, This is Fran, I think. Maybe yes.
I suddenly look over your left shoulder and tell me if that's...
Hello, I'm Fran Drescher. I'm checking in. Excuse me, Miss Fran Drescher, but I am your biggest fan.
Oh, thank you.
My God, you really do talk like that.
I would make this up.
So I see you're into the flat hair in real life.
Yeah, it's not for you.
You think it makes me look fat?
The bigger the hat, the smaller the hats.
She learned that from your show. Tell me something. What's the butler like? Is he as funny in person? I think he steals the whole show.
Can I interject? I thought you were so fabulous in My Cousin Vinny. Did you keep your Oscar at Marissa Tomei's house? Are you two here on vacation?
Oh, no, we're here spying on her husband who's having an affair with my girlfriend.
We did that very same story this season. Really? I didn't see that. When was it on? Now. And don't forget to watch the series finale next week. Oh, I wouldn't miss it for the world. Unless, of course, that's the night I'm having my twins.
What's PCOM? A magic payroll genie?
I know. Okay. Anyway, that's Fran Drescher. That's nasal tone. Has to do with nasal tone. Fluency disorders are disruptions of the normal rate of speech pattern. Stuttering is an example of a fluency disorder. These are famous people who were stutterers. Wait a second. Famous people who were stutterers. I've already told you. Okay. Joe Biden, of course, talks about it all the time. James Earl Jones. Bruce Willis. He now has a different problem. Form of dementia. Nicole Kidman. Marilyn Monroe. All stutterers. And Glenn, the wife of former astronaut Senator John Glenn, who has since died. Both of them have passed away. Winston Churchill was a stutterer. Jim Davis from my hometown of Muncie, Indiana. Lewis Carroll wrote Alice in Wonderland. B.B. King. Mark Anthony, Mike Brill, if you have ever seen that, my dog was involved in Tiger Woods was a stutter. And they were all stutters. All right. Thank you. More to see. Articulation disorders are where an individual has a difficult time making specific sounds. The most common articulation disorder is replacing the R and the L sound with the W sound. They may also make a D sound for the TH sound. Lisping is an articulation disorder. And this is a famous articulation.
Sounds like Penny really got to him. I'm not surprised. Despite his hard and crusty shell, Howard is a very sensitive man. Do you know he writes poetry? Mostly about men from Nantucket and hermits named Dave. But he does it with real sensitivity.
Hey, Hofstadter. Wonder when the plasma lab is, you built a robot?
Yes, we did, Kripke.
His name is Monty.
Well, if you have any delusions about entering against my robot, the Kripke Crippler, in the Southern California Robot Fighting League Round Robin Invitational, a.k.a. the SCRFLRRI, his name is going to be Scrap Metal.
Come on, is that really necessary?
Leonard, I believe it is. This is trash talk. Trash talk is a traditional component in all sporting events. Kripke, your robot is inferior, and it will be defeated by ours, because ours exceeds yours in both design and execution. Also, I'm given to understand that your mother is overweight.
Oh, snap.
Now, of course, if that is the result of a glandular condition and not sloth and gluttony, I withdraw that comment.
What difference does it make? Fat is fat.
There are boundaries.
Tell you what, forget the STRFLROI. Let's settle this wabato a wabato.
What do you mean?
There's no guarantee we're going to go against each other in the Wild Robin, so let's slow down. You know, unless you have Wade.
We accept your challenge. Name a time and place.
Tomorrow, 3 o'clock, the Kinetics Web.
Make it so.
No, don't make it so. Barry, we can't fight you tomorrow. Our engineer is incapacitated.
What's wrong with him?
He's depressed because he's pathetic and creepy and can't get girls.
We're all pathetic and creepy and can't get girls. That's why we fight robots. If you're not there, you'll be exposed to ridicule.
I'm curious, what part of America is that accent from?
Okay, we got one more. Lisp. Lisping. Whoops, that one's gone. Okay, well, that happens. Reading involves word recognition, identifying a unique pattern of letters and comprehension, extracting meaning from a group of words. One of the hallmarks of learning to read is learning the names of the letters. Researchers have discovered that children who learn to read the best are those who know their ABCs, and this is something that we are teaching in preschool now. A second necessity in learning to read is phonological awareness, the ability to hear and recognize the sounds of the letters. This skill will be a predictor of reading skills throughout the child's developmental period and marks a good adult reader from a poor one. Reading is taught in two major ways, whole word method and phonics. Whole word method teaches the child to recognize the whole word, while phonics teaches the child to break the word down into its basic sound structure. Each method has its merits. Whole word creates better readers. Phonics allows readers who are having difficulty recognizing words a technique to sound them out. It makes it more likely that the student will try if you do phonics. Now, strangely enough, I learned the whole word method, but I have a brother and an older brother and sister that had problems reading, and they didn't really learn to read very well until they developed the phonics method. Now, the phonics method, you think, well, it's been around forever. Well, the phonics method hasn't been around forever. They started using it in schools in the 1950s. And, of course, my sister started in 1954. My brother started in 1952. So, is that right? Yeah, I guess so, 1952. Anyway, so... They didn't really learn to read until they started using the phonics method. But I was able to read using the whole word method. As children begin to read and comprehend what they are reading, they develop increased working memory, capacity to encompass longer and longer sentences, and increased general knowledge of their physical, social, and psychological worlds. Children begin using expanded and more appropriate reading strategies with experience. Children are better able to monitor their comprehension. Humans are just about the only species that raises their young in a family unit. Anthropologists and evolutionary psychologists believe that families are prevalent among humans in order to assure that offspring will survive to reproduce. Humans are unable to survive on their own for several years after birth. Parenting involves two dimensions, degree of warmth and responsiveness to the parent shows, and the amount of control they exert over their children. Authoritarian parents have a high amount of control and little warmth. The parents establish strict rules and expect their children to obey them without question. There is little interaction between the parents and their children except for the parent dictating actions and the child following. Permissive parenting style offers warmth and caring, little parental control. These parents accept anything that the children want to do. They punish infrequently. This isn't good for the child because their brains are not mature enough to make these decisions. Authoritative parenting has a fair degree of parenting control, warm and tends to be responsive. It has a great deal of interaction between parents and children. The rules are set down, explained, and if need be, discussed. Rejecting, neglecting parenting provide no warmth and provide no control. Often the parents' desires come before the child's. They attempt to minimize the amount of time they spend with their children. They do not get emotionally involved with their own children. Parenting styles vary across cultures. Asian cultures tend to be more collectivist and therefore accentuate a child's being cooperative rather than individualistic and sticking out. Parenting in collectivist environments are less likely to support the expression of affection as compared to more individualistic cultures as in the United States. Parenting styles also vary widely within the same culture. Parents today do more explaining than was traditional 4 or 5 decades ago. This parenting model is referred to as direct instruction, where the parent explains to the child what to do, when to do it, and why they are doing it. This is often done by tying emotions and behavior. Modeling, children learn as much by watching their parents and doing what they see them do as formal instruction. And of course, this is known as modeling. For an older sister or brother, the first sibling is an encroachment on their exclusive time with their parents. The new birth is often distressing to the older sibling. Often an older child will regress and start acting younger than they are or normally do. One thing that often helps the family unit is that fathers often become more involved in the older children's lives as the mother becomes more occupied with the newborn. Many older siblings enjoy helping their parents with the care of the newborn. In some cultures, older daughters are expected to help care for their young siblings. Sibling relationships are not easy. Some siblings will become best friends, while others will be based on conflict, arguing, and rivalry. Relationships are often set early in the interactions, and this is a family of three, and as you can see, one sister likes her brother and the other one doesn't. Sibling relationships are based on several factors. Gender, same-sex siblings often act more harmonious than opposite-sex siblings. Temperament, the more similar the temperaments, the less likely the siblings will deal with each other emotionally. Age, siblings tend to improve the relationships as they enter adolescence. Siblings who don't get along often feel that their parents have favorites in the family. Parents should be careful about praising one child over the other. Too much praise for one child may lead to undue rivalry. Now, the reality is, this is pretty close to being true. Parents do show a favoritism for one child over the other. Very common. May not happen in all cultures, but it certainly does happen in the United States. The quality of the parents' relationship will often dictate how the siblings will interact. A warm, harmonious relationship between parents will often foster positive sibling relationships. Firstborns, parents have high expectations for the firstborn. They're more affectionate toward these children. They're more punitive toward them. Generally, they have higher scores on IQ tests. They're more likely to be successful. They're more adult-oriented and more likely to conform to parents' wishes. And here's two examples of firstborns, Albert Einstein and Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Had IQs of 160. Pretty smart. More conscientious, the firstborns are more conscientious, ambitious, and aggressive than their younger siblings. Firstborns are overrepresented at Harvard and Yale, as well as disciplines requiring higher education, such as medicine, engineering, or law. Every astronaut to go into space has been either the oldest child in his or her family, or the eldest boy. And throughout history, even when large families were the norm, more than half of all Nobel Prize winners and U.S. presidents have been firstborn. That wasn't true of is true of Joe Biden. It wasn't true of Donald Trump. He had an older brother. Who else do we have? Barack Obama was the oldest in his family. Bill Clinton was the oldest in his family, and you know, on and on and on. Famous eldest children, Joe Biden, Hillary Clinton, Bill Clinton, Richard Branson, J.K. Rowling, and Winston Churchill were all firstborns. And macho movie stars are firstborn too, including Clint Eastwood, John Wayne, Sylvester Stallone, Bruce Willis, and all the actors who have ever played James Bond. Middle children are more easygoing and peer-oriented. Since they can get lost in the shuffle of their own families, they learn to build bridges to other sources of support, and therefore they tend to have excellent people skills. Middle children often take on the role of mediator and peacemaker. Famous middle children include Bill Gates, JFK, Madonna, Donald Trump, Chris Hemsworth, Jennifer Lopez, Peyton Manning, Britney Spears, and Princess Diana. They were all famous middle children. The youngest child tends to be the most creative and can be very charming, even manipulative. Because they often identify with the underdog, they tend to champion egalitarian causes. Youngest siblings were the earliest backer of the Protestant Reformation and the Enlightenment, successful in journalism, advertising, sales, and the arts. My youngest brother, we used to call him Baby David because he was the baby of the family. Hates it to this day, but that didn't stop us. Famous youngest children include Cameron Diaz, Jim Carrey, Drew Carey, Rosie O'Donnell, Eddie Murphy, Jennifer Lawrence, Harry Styles, Ryan Gosling, Angelina Jolie, George Clooney, Zoe Saldana, Jude Law, and Billy Crystal were all babies of the family. Laterborns, less concerned about pleasing parents, they are more rebellious, they're more popular with their peers, they tend to be more innovative. Parents have more realistic expectations. Parents tend to have more relaxed discipline for laterborns. Onlys, they're rumored to be selfish and egotistical. Actually, no, they're no worse off than children born in any other birth order. So they succeed more in school. They have higher levels of intelligence, leadership, autonomy, and maturity. Famous Onlys, Lance Armstrong was an Only, Frank Sinatra, Natalie Portman, Robin Williams, Tiger Woods, Franklin Roosevelt, Robert De Niro, and Elvis Presley. The third crisis in Erikson's psychosocial theory takes place between the ages of 3 and 6 and encompasses initiative versus guilt when the child learns to try new things or doesn't. If the child is allowed to explore, they will develop an active attitude, which will translate as personal autonomy. If the child expands their realm of influence outside that of their family, they are more likely to develop autonomy. And this is my grandson and his buddy JJ again. If the child is stunted by their family or themselves, they will have a difficult time developing a sense of autonomy. They may feel shame for their lack of inner drive. When they do attempt to be autonomous, it may feel incorrect for them, causing them to feel guilt. And that is the end. Now, I apologize. I think I went to sleep a couple times while I was lecturing. That tends to happen on these hot summer days. You can notice where it is. There are usually times when I paused or I didn't make any sense with what I was saying. So I apologize. But I'll talk to you guys next week.